Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Nightfall's Prophet by T.A. White. Narrated by Natasha Soudek. 1. I felt ridiculous. I was pretty sure I looked it too. My arms pumping, my chin lifted as if it could make me even a tiny bit faster. I power walked like my life depended on it down the sidewalk to the cute downtown where my niece's ballet recital was taking place. 15 minutes late and counting. I hated being late. Loathed it, really. Unfortunately, pelting through the streets at a mad dash wasn't likely to fix my tardiness. Rather, it would only serve to draw unnecessary attention and leave me out of breath and sweaty upon arrival. I rounded the corner, feeling a wave of relief at the sight of my destination up ahead. Almost there. If I'd known beforehand how stinking far this place was, I would have chanced parallel parking my precious, a burnt umber Jaguar F-type that I'd nicknamed Gwyneth, instead of circling the block a few times looking for a garage. As I hurried, the phone in my back pocket buzzed. The unexpected vibration made me miss a step. Cursing under my breath, I fished it out to take a glance at the screen. Thomas, my sire. Definitely not going to answer that. The man must have some kind of radar that only went off when I was doing something I shouldn't be. How else could I explain his impeccable timing? Strictly speaking, maintaining contact with your mortal family was frowned upon in vampire society, to the point where most vampire sires preferred to stage their yearlings' deaths to make a clean break, after which further contact was forbidden. As cruel as it sounded, they had their reasons. Most yearlings were considered highly dangerous in the first decade or so after their transition. Our history was littered with stories of yearlings returning home, only to slaughter their nearest and dearest the first time they got a little peckish. Imagine having to spend eternity knowing you'd chowed down on mom, dad, and your baby sister or brother. Some vampires were so overcome with guilt, they never recovered. A few, unable to handle what they'd done, sought the oblivion of true death afterward. That's why it was considered safer for both sides if the yearlings simply disappeared from their former family's life. Maybe that was the reason those with fewer family ties were preferred when it came to the transition. It was just one less thing binding them to the mortal world. Had my transition been normal, I'm sure that would have been my fate too. Instead, I'd woken up in a morgue, having no idea what had happened to me, or why I suddenly had fangs. I'd been left to figure it out as I went. With no master to guide me, there was nothing to stop me from resuming as much of my former life as I could. Good decision or bad, I'd returned home to my family. Now that I was wiser, I still wasn't quite ready to give them up. Not unless I absolutely had to. It was a choice Thomas and others frowned upon, and also the reason I had kept secret the fact I was meeting them tonight. With a grimace, I hit ignore and stuffed the phone into my back pocket. Thomas was just going to have to lecture me later. I was already late enough as it was. I'd almost reached the building when the presence of another on the street caught my attention. Half-cast in shadow, the man stood eerily still as he stared at the doors of the auditorium. The absence of life in his face made it easy to mistake him for a statue. He simply waited, not moving, not blinking. I don't think he was even breathing. "Connor, you're not supposed to be here." I thought I'd made that quite clear when I'd slipped out of the mansion without informing anyone of where I was going. Life brought a hint of animation to Connor's face as his chest started to rise and fall again. If I was feeling poetic, I'd use words like moonlight and starlight to describe the man. From his white blonde hair that looked almost silver, to his pale skin that carried a certain luminescence to it, it was hard to believe he'd ever been human. His features were a little too perfect. His bright blue eyes stood out even more against his otherwise monochromatic coloring. Connor's gaze tracked me as I reached for the door handle. We're partners, aren't we? Partners follow each other. I paused to stare at him. You maybe should have run that statement through your brain filter a few more times before you let it into the open. Maybe then he would have sounded a little less like a stalker. Not that it would have made much difference in this conversation. Connor was being obtuse, deliberately so. As much as he pretended ignorance, I knew he was highly observant. It was how he'd survived so long in situations that would have quickly ended any other. This has to do with family, I explained. My family, the one I could feel getting more and more distant. I needed this night to go well.
We're family, too.
This was the problem with Connor. His sincerity. As ruthless and smart as any other vampire, he also possessed an innocence that made it impossible to sustain the barriers I normally encased my cold, shriveled heart in. Damn it. I had no defenses against him. Fine, you can come. If there had been a trace of triumph in his expression, a speck of smugness to signify manipulation, I could have denied him. But there wasn't. And that was why he got away with things others couldn't. His sincerity disarmed me. If he ever weaponized it, I was toast. Not a word about vampires, though.
I understand.
Did he? Because the bright excitement in his eyes didn't make me think so. I yanked open the door and stalked inside. I'm going to regret this. But likely not as much as Connor when he realized letting him come meant watching 7-year-olds who hadn't quite mastered the use of their limbs dance. We slipped inside the auditorium as quietly as possible, careful not to create a disturbance that would detract from the performance. I scanned the rows for 2 empty seats, hopefully somewhere inconspicuous that would allow me to pretend we'd been here the whole time. I never got the chance to make a move, as a person toward the front third of the auditorium turned. She lifted a hand, summoning us with an imperious wave. There went my idea of blending into the background. The thought of disobeying the invitation didn't occur to me. Vampires were scary. My sister was scarier. Into the breach we go, I muttered, before trudging forward with all the enthusiasm of an inmate approaching execution. It might have been my imagination, but I could have sworn I felt the irate gazes of disgruntled parents burning into the back of my head as we slipped down the aisle. It was hard not to feel self-conscious with everyone staring at us as a line of tiny ballerinas walked across the stage and started lifting and lowering their arms out of sync. I sped up, reaching the road Jenna had claimed. The man I'd always considered my father sat on the end. His face brightened at the sight of me, and he started to scoot back. He paused as his gaze caught on Connor at my side, something flashing across his face. Dad? I asked in confusion. The distracted look on his face faded, to be replaced by the same smile he'd had at my arrival. This time a little less bright, and a touch smaller, but still genuine.
Sorry, yes, of course.
He finished making room for Connor and I to slip by. Going first, I bent over so I wouldn't block the view of those behind us. Connor was graceful as he navigated the obstacle course of legs, chairs, and belongings. I, on the other hand, nearly face-planted when my foot got caught in the strap of Jenna's purse, forcing me to grab the back of the row in front of us or fall. The couple seated there turned to shoot me a dirty look. I shot them a conciliatory smile, pretending not to hear the whispered, "Rude," from the woman as she faced front again. A blast of chill came from Connor as he eyed the woman's neck with a calculating stare. Knowing how protective he could be, and how brutally efficient his retaliation, I slapped his arm in warning. His gaze didn't move from the woman's neck. I pinched the back of his hand, my nails digging into his skin when he didn't react. It was only when I was in danger of drawing blood that he finally moved his attention from the woman to me. I gave him a warning look. He was going to behave, or else. I didn't know what that "or else" was, but I'd figure it out. His lips twitched the faintest bit as he drew his hand out of my grip to pat mine in comfort. I scowled, not believing his promises for a second. Connor might look amiable and even a little introverted, but he was a stubborn bastard. It wasn't like the stubbornness of others, either, those who spoke loudly and fiercely. It was quieter, the kind that it took you a while to notice. You could give him all the orders in the world, but if he didn't want to do something, he wouldn't. Most of the time, he wouldn't even argue with you. Your advice would go in one ear and out the other, while he went about doing things the way he wanted. Knowing it was useless to pursue the matter, I collapsed into the seat next to Jenna. Connor did the same on my opposite side, managing to make the movement as graceful as everything else he did. Jenna wasted no time leaning toward me. "You're late." "I know. I'm sorry. I underestimated how long it would take me to walk through the house my realtor wanted to show me." It was a lie. But telling Jenna that a group of kobolds had gotten a touch stabby and had to be taught a lesson in why vampires, even baby ones, weren't to be messed with, wasn't an option. Connor looked at me out of the corner of his eye, the ends of his mouth rising in a micro-expression. He was happy. Because I'd lied? Or because he knew the truth when Jenna didn't? "You found a house?" I shook my head. "No, not yet." Probably not ever, with the way the housing market was. Inventory was at an all-time low with anything that was even remotely reasonably priced being snatched up in an instant. "Mom didn't come?" I asked, glancing down the row of chairs to find Connor had taken the last empty seat. The rest were filled, making me wonder if perhaps my mother was going to show up in a few minutes and have nowhere to sit. Jenna's expression was strained. "I didn't invite her." I stared at Jenna for a beat, a little impressed. That wasn't like her. The woman who tended to give way to keep the peace. Maybe she really was being honest when she said she wanted to be a better sister. Over the past few months, she'd made every attempt to repair the fractures in our relationship, starting with her offer to help me search for my bio dad, an offer I hadn't needed to take her up on since he'd come looking for me. Since we'd reconnected, she'd been careful not to push too hard, respecting the boundaries I set. The ones I'd formed to protect her and the rest of my family from the dangerous world I found myself part of. "I'm sure she wasn't pleased about that," I muttered. Jenna's frustrated laugh made me think that was an understatement. The woman in front of us twisted in her seat. "Do you mind? Some of us are trying to watch the program." Jenna's smile was contrite. "I apologize, Vicky. We'll try to be quiet." The woman shot her disdainful glower before sneering at me. "I shouldn't be surprised that Linda's family is as ill-mannered as her, arriving late, gossiping during the performance. This isn't a social gathering." I inhaled sharply, feeling a little lightheaded from my anger. I'd heard just about enough out of her. I could let go the nastiness earlier because it was my fault. I'd created a disturbance, however unintentional, with my late arrival. When you made mistakes, you took your lumps. The end. Bringing my niece's name into matters was a no-go. You didn't touch my family. Not ever. Jenna had apologized. Continuing to harp on matters was pure pettiness. My dad leaned forward and lowered his voice.
Ma'am, my daughter already apologized once. I suggest you face front and pay attention to the rest of the recital before matters escalate any further.
The words sounded polite, but everybody could hear what he really meant. If Vicky didn't take him up on his offer, he would be happy to accompany her on the road to hell. It was rare for my dad to lose his temper, but when he did, it was always memorable.
Uncertainty and insult fought for dominance in the woman's expression. Before either could win, the man seated next to her grabbed her shoulder and forced her to face front.
"Enough. You're embarrassing me."
"Richard!" the woman protested, sounding like she didn't understand why he was upset. Jenna and I traded identical looks before dissolving into silent giggles that caused our shoulders to shake. Dad sent us a chiding glance, the kind that all parents had perfected on their children. He lifted a finger to his mouth to shush us. Jenna and I nodded quickly, the occasional snort giggle breaking through our attempted seriousness. We were careful not to look at each other. The moment we did, the jig would be up. There'd be no fighting back our laughter then. I bit my lip, rolling it between my teeth to keep my snickers to myself as I stared at the stage.
"Don't laugh. Don't laugh. Don't you do it. Otherwise, Vicky might turn around and fuss at us again."
The thought nearly set off another chain of giggles. Only catching Connor staring at me brought me back to reality.
"What?" I mouthed. "You and your father are similar."
Connor's voice was a bare thread of sound that was undetectable to human ears.
"Of course," I responded, using the same volume. "He's the one who raised me, after all. He taught me everything I know."
We might not have shared DNA, but there was more to a parent-slash-child relationship than just genetics. He'd been there every step of the way during my transition from childhood to adulthood, guiding me where I needed it, providing a safe harbor in those moments when I found myself lost and unsure. He was my hero. He was the reason I had a habit of rescuing misfits. He could never stand when people were bullies. I couldn't either. Our temperaments were similar. Dad seemed mild-mannered until he wasn't, particularly when the people he loved the most were in jeopardy of being trampled on. Connor's face was thoughtful as he studied my father. I left him to it, settling in to watch the recital. It was every bit as painful as I thought it would be. A good number of the ballerinas seemed to have forgotten the steps. They looked to others, following along a beat behind everyone else. There was one particular cutie who got bored halfway through and found something interesting on the side of the stage to examine. The teacher motioned at her to return to the line, but the child remained intent on her new toy. It was adorable. A few in the crowd laughed as one of the parents got up and approached the edge of the stage to try to help the teacher. In the middle of the group, my niece twirled. She was one of the few who'd actually remembered the steps. Although her movements contained more enthusiasm than skill, she was having fun. Her smile was as big as her face. My phone vibrated 3 more times during the course of the rest of the performance. I ignored it each time, intent on not letting my sire ruin this rare evening out.
"You should answer that," Connor advised. "The longer you wait, the pushier he'll get."
At that moment, his phone let out a merry jingle, causing those nearby to give us more dirty looks. I refrained from laughing, raising my eyebrows at him instead.
"What's that you were saying?"
Connor's expression was grumpy as he stared straight ahead.
"I think that's you,"
Jenna whispered when he didn't move to answer the phone. Reluctantly, Connor reached into his pocket. I caught the word sire on the screen before he hit the button to silence his ringer.
"Come now, avoiding him will only make him pushier," I teased,
a little too happy that the shoe was on the other foot. Connor pretended not to hear my dig as applause broke out around us. I grinned, rising with the rest and clapping to the end of the performance. My niece beamed from her place in the middle of the pack. It might have been bias on my part, but I thought she was the best one out there. I let out a sharp whistle of appreciation. The sound attracted Linda's attention. If possible, she beamed even harder. Her smile so wide, it nearly split her face. If I needed a reminder of why I'd sat through an hour of torture surrounded by snotty parents, this was it. She looked like I'd handed her the sun, the stars, and everything in between. Moments like this were why I'd never be able to fully walk away from my family. It was true, they drove me crazy. Feelings on both sides had been hurt. Some of it was my fault, some of it theirs, but they were worth the effort. One day, these moments and these people would be gone. I needed to make the time we still had together count. Linda darted for the edge of the stage before anyone could stop her. She hopped down and raced in our direction, leaving her teacher staring at her in consternation. Her fellow dancers milled around in confusion, a few looking like they wanted to follow. The teacher clapped to get their attention. Like little guppies, they grouped around her and let her shepherd them toward the wings. Linda reached our row, her face alight with excitement.
"Aunt Aileen, you came!"
"I told you I would." Whatever my failings, I at least tried to keep my promises, even if I was late. Linda scooted past her grandfather and mother, pretending not to see my sister lean down to give her a hug. Jenna frowned at me as her daughter wiggled away from her arms. I stuck my tongue out at her. "It's because she likes me better." Jenna's glare was fulminating.
"I'm so glad you got to see the recital, Aunt Aileen. I was worried work would keep you late. I know how important your job is."
Linda barely paused to draw breath, already launching into the next round before I could respond.
"What did you think of my dance? Miss Dinkle said I'm one of the best in my class. She said my arabesques and jetés are advanced for my age, but that my pirouettes need work. It's really hard."
My eyes began to glaze over with the influx of information. I pretended to understand all of her words as I nodded at appropriate intervals. I owed Jenna an apology. If this was what she'd been dealing with as a single mother all these years, she was beyond impressive. Honestly, I wasn't sure how she was still sane. Were all kids like this? From Linda's exuberance, you'd never know that a few months ago she'd been sick enough for a hospital stay. One where words like cancer had been bandied about. Doctors were stunned when she made a miraculous recovery. No one but Thomas, Liam, and I knew it was because of my sire. Evidently, a powerful vampire's blood acted like a panacea for most human ailments, cancer included. I owed Thomas. He'd saved Linda when I couldn't. There was no getting around that. It was a debt I had to remember. "All right, miss." Jenna's perfectly timed interruption coincided with Linda's need for breath. "I don't think you're supposed to be down here. Why don't you return to the stage before Ms. Dinkle takes back all the nice things she's said about you? Your aunt will be here when you're done."
"Mom, you can't take back compliments already given."
Linda's scowl was adorable.
"Everyone knows that."
Jenna made a face at her daughter.
"Oh, they do, do they?
But you're right. I shouldn't miss Ms. Dinkle's after performance review."
Linda waved at me.
"See you later, Aunt Aileen."
She slipped through the narrow gap between the seats before stopping in front of her grandpa for a hug.
"Are we still going to the pancake house afterward, Grandpa?"
Dad enfolded Linda in a bear hug, pressing his cheek to the top of her head in the process.
"I have to reward my best granddaughter somehow, don't I?"
"I'm your only granddaughter, silly."
"I thought you were joining the rest of your class," Jenna said. Linda danced away from my dad.
I'm going.
Jenna shook her head as Linda wove between adults in the aisle, her figure quickly disappearing in the crowd. I swear, I don't know where she gets it from.
Jenna said with a shake of her head. She gets more stubborn every day. I lifted my eyebrows at Jenna.
Really? You don't know?
Did she not remember who had raised us? Our mother was the queen of stubborn, the empress of the sharp retort, and a woman who could silence her children with a single glance. Jenna gave me a dry look.
Ah, right. I forgot she has you as an aunt.
I made a face back at her as we moved into the aisle and toward the exit. My father ignored our antics to hold a hand out to Connor.
My name's Patrick. I didn't get a chance to introduce myself earlier.
Connor stared at my dad's hand with puzzlement before reaching out to shake it.
You may call me Connor.
Jenna leaned against my shoulder. She dropped her voice to a whisper.
Is he the reason you didn't agree to move in with me until you found a new place?
I could have warned her that it was pointless to whisper, and that Connor had probably heard every word out of her mouth. But where was the fun in that? Of course not. We're strictly platonic. Jenna wiggled her eyebrows at me.
Does that mean you're still dating Tall, Dark, and Delicious? His name was Liam, right?
Somehow the word dating, when used in conjunction with Liam, seemed like a tepid description for what we were doing.
Yes.
I shrugged her arm off my shoulder as we reached the exit.
What's with all the questions about my dating life?
Jenna's expression was innocent.
I'm your sister. This is the type of things sisters discuss.
I fixed her with a hard look that said she wasn't fooling me.
By the way, where is Liam?
Jenna made a show of looking around. I was hoping he'd come with you so I could play 20 questions with him.
Note to self, don't let Jenna within spitting distance of my vampire boyfriend. He'd have way too much fun with anything she asked.
He was busy tonight, I said evasively. In truth, I hadn't asked him. I wasn't sure if he would have said yes. Although he'd met Jenna and my dad multiple times, it hadn't been with the label of my official boyfriend. There was also Liam's history with his mortal family and the complicated feelings the topic brought him.
How do you know my daughter?
Dad was asking Connor.
I'm her brother.
The resulting silence made me wish we were still talking about my love life, as Dad and Jenna went very quiet.
A brother in arms, I was quick to clarify with an awkward laugh, seeing the question in their eyes. Not a blood-related brother.
Connor's expression was a little stiff at my denial.
Right, Connor?
I nudged him with an elbow.
He'd better back me up on this. There would be hell to pay if he didn't.
Reluctantly, Connor nodded.
Aileen saved my life. I owe her more than I can ever repay.
My relief was short-lived as Dad contemplated the two of us with a serious expression and a gaze that saw right through me. He knew, or at least suspected, there was more to the story, that I was hiding something important. I held my breath, waiting for the hammer to fall. Dad had always had a knack for detecting my lies.
No combat, huh? I guess all those assurances you gave me and your mother were bullshit.
My mind went blank.
I'd forgotten I'd told my parents that I never left the FOB, forward operating base, during deployment. One of my bigger lies now exposed while covering for another lie.
Dad was quick to let me off the hook, the amused glint in his eye telling me he'd known the truth all along.
You're home safe now. That's all we can ask for.
Connor's not just my friend. He's my business partner, too, I blurted out.
Is he now? Then I guess it's good you two have history,
Dad said. Jenna coughed under her breath.
Coward!
Without looking, I swatted her arm with the back of my hand.
Shush you!
Her laugh came as Linda burst out of the crowd. In the short time since we'd seen her, my niece had shed her tutu and was now wearing a thin jacket and pants over her ballet outfit. Her hair was still in its tight bun, and glitter covered her face. She slid to a stop in front of Connor, looking up at him like he was the eighth world wonder.
Who are you?
Linda asked in a hushed voice that made me wonder if 7-year-olds were capable of falling in love at first sight. Connor's face held a trace of gentleness.
My name is Connor. I'm Aileen's brother.
Linda nodded, accepting his words the way only a child would, without question or hesitation. She held her arms out to Connor.
Will you pick me up? My legs hurt.
Linda! Jenna gasped. Don't be rude. You're too big for that. Her protest came too late. Connor had already leaned down, carefully closing his arms around Linda, as if she was a fragile treasure. He straightened, lifting her as easily as a feather. From her new vantage, Linda looked around with excitement at being so high up.
Are you sure? Jenna asked hesitantly. You don't have to.
The look Jenna shot her daughter held both embarrassment over her daughter's behavior and a warning that she'd better straighten up, or else. Connor acted like he hadn't heard as he glanced at my dad.
You mentioned pancakes.
Dad took his time studying him.
I did, didn't I?
Dad winked at Linda. She giggled, burying her face in Connor's neck.
We wouldn't want to disappoint, would we?
Dad asked Linda.
No.
Dad offered his arms to me and Jenna.
Shall we, girls?
With a smirk, I hooked one arm with his before looking at Jenna in expectation. She stared at us for a moment before releasing a growl that sounded cute when compared to the terrifying snarls of a werewolf.
You're going to spoil her,
Jenna chided. Linda started bouncing in Connor's arms.
We're off to see the pancakes, the wonderful, wonderful pancakes of ours.
A little spoiling never hurt anyone,
Dad whispered back. Jenna shot him a displeased look.
You're not the one who has to deal with her later.
I leaned around Dad.
That's the perk of being a grandpa and aunt. We got to wind the kids up and reap all the fun before abandoning them to their parents, who would have to deal with the consequences.
I pumped my fist in the air.
Pancakes!
Linda squealed and did the same.
Pancakes!
Dad and Connor looked at each other in consensus.
Oh, no,
Jenna moaned. The men smirked and then pumped their fists in the air.
Pancakes!
2. A 10-minute walk later, the 5 of us were settling into a booth while Linda rattled off her order to the waitress without stopping to look at the menu once. It turns out she and my father were frequent visitors.
How about you, hon?
The waitress asked when it got to my turn. Just coffee, please.
You're not eating, Aunt Aileen?
Linda looked flabbergasted at the idea someone would forgo the sugary goodness that was her obsession.
You have to. These are the best pancakes in Columbus, maybe even the world. They're soft and fluffy. When you get blueberries in them, they are so tasty.
Sorry, Sprout, I said, ignoring the concern on Jenna and my dad's faces.
I didn't know you were being rewarded with such awesomeness when I ate dinner earlier. If I tried to stuff my face with as much food as you just ordered, my stomach would pop like a balloon.
My answer surprised a giggle out of my niece. Jenna smiled and poked her daughter, making her laugh harder as my dad stretched an arm across the back of their booth. It seemed they'd bought my lie. A relief, since not too long ago they'd been convinced I had a drinking problem. The ironic part was that I did, in fact, have a drinking problem. Just not the way they thought. Connor closed his menu and handed it to the waitress.
I'll have the cinnamon triple stack with a side of bacon and ham.
I blinked rapidly. Sure, I hadn't heard that right.
You'll what now?
Connor had the same limitations I did. While vampires could eat food in moderation, they mostly didn't because of the damage it could do to our systems. In simple terms, food acted like an allergen, the resulting inflammation affecting us in unexpected ways. In severe cases, it could lead to devolution, which was the path I was on until Thomas intervened. It was also why I couldn't have any food at all. It was too bad. I'd once loved food more than air.
Not being able to taste my favorites was like having a limb removed. I missed it so much. The confusion on my family's faces had me backtracking. I mean, are you sure? Your dinner was bigger than mine. How are you going to fit all that food in your stomach?
I'm older than you. I can handle it.
This little shit. He just played the age card with me. I let him join one family outing, and he was already roasting me in the best of sibling traditions. Jenna ducked her head to hide her reaction. She wasn't quite successful as several snorts escaped her. My dad lifted his cup of coffee to hide his smile. Traitors. The both of them. Linda's eyes got very big with excitement.
Does this mean I get to eat more when I'm as old as you?
It does.
Linda kicked her feet and bounced in her seat.
I can't wait. I have so many plans.
Sadly, my niece would have a longer wait than she expected, since Connor had been alive for centuries. While our order was being prepared, Linda told us everything we needed to know about how school was going. From what Mrs. Pax, her second grade teacher, wore on each day of the week. Apparently themes were involved. How Linda was really looking forward to Monday since she planned to wear the same thing as her teacher. To the complete anatomy of the social hierarchy in her class. Newsflash, Linda was at the center of it all. Jen and I shared a look of bafflement, our thoughts following a similar vein. Linda was her own little person. I could see elements of her mother in her, traits from her grandma and grandpa as well. Then there was this whole other side that made me wonder where it came from. While Jenna had always been part of the more popular crowd in school, unlike me, who'd been content to float around the edges, she'd also been a bit of a pushover. Linda sounded more like someone willing to throw down for a fight. Maybe that was my influence. Or maybe it came from her father, a man whose name no one knew, except Jenna. Either way, it was a joy to see the person she was becoming. By the time our food arrived, Linda had moved on to describe her summer plans, which involved an outdoor adventure I was pretty sure hadn't been run by her mom.
Here we are. The waitress set a plate down in front of Linda. One blueberry stack with extra powdered sugar.
Linda licked her lips at the sight of the three kid-sized pancakes stacked on top of each other. The waitress set the next plate in front of Jenna.
One lemon ricotta pancake. Hold the sugar.
Jenna smiled in thanks.
And a farmer's special for the gentleman.
The waitress winked at my dad as she gave him his plate before setting the remaining mountain of pancakes in front of Connor.
And last but not least, the triple-deck cinnamon burst pancakes for the other gentleman.
Triple the size of Linda's stack? It looked like there were enough pancakes on Connor's plate to feed the whole table.
Wow!
Linda breathed in amazement, eyeing Connor's pancakes with envy. Focus on your own plate, miss. Jenna warned,
but
eat your pancakes. Linda's sigh was way more world-weary than any seven-year-old had the right to be. With a shrug, she dug into her pancakes, the first bite making her forget she'd ever coveted Connor's. While Jen and my dad picked up their forks, Connor studied his stack with an intensity reserved for the strange and unusual. I pretended to sip at my coffee as I eyed his sugary goodness, wanting nothing more than to take it off his hands.
Cinnamon. Yum. I loved cinnamon. I loved pancakes, too. Why couldn't I have been bitten by a werewolf instead of a vampire? At least then I could eat all the food I wanted. Instead, I got blood. Yummy blood, but still.
Regret not ordering? Jenna quirked an eyebrow at me. I slumped into my seat, not bothering to pretend. She'd know, anyways.
She can't. Connor poked a pancake with a fork. She's on a specialized diet for her health.
That caught the adult's attention. Jenna and Dad paused in their meal, focusing on Connor. Jenna sent a quick look at Dad, a silent communication taking place between them in the space of a heartbeat.
Dad lifted his mug to take a sip of coffee, allowing Jenna to take the lead. There was a vigilance in the way he eyed Connor and me over the rim of his cup that said he cared more about what was being said than he was letting on. We had his full attention. "Is this about the illness you mentioned when Linda was in the hospital?" Jenna asked, trying and failing to feign nonchalance. The slow and deliberate way she cut her pancakes was what gave her away. Like my dad, she was wholly absorbed in the conversation, even while being careful not to appear too eager. I sent Connor a sidelong look, blaming him for this. As long as we didn't bring up the subject, they'd been content to pretend it wasn't there. That no longer applied. Connor didn't notice my disgruntlement, carefully watching the way Jenna was cutting her pancakes before following suit. I guess it was up to me to think of a good excuse. You could say that. I fiddled with the handle of my mug, drawing my dad's attention. Knowing fidgeting was a sign of nerves, I put my hands in my lap and smiled at them. The doctors think a more restrictive diet will help reduce inflammation, which might make my illness easier to treat. My dad set his coffee cup on the table. Is it serious, this illness? The concern in his face made me pause. It held a mixture of love and worry. Behind it all was a fear that things were more serious than I was letting on. No parent wanted to hear their child was sick. They wanted to see them suffer even less. My dad was no different. I reached out and took his hand, noting how warm it was compared to mine. I won't die from this. Dad's eyes were rimmed with red as he looked down at the table. But I won't be able to live the same way I did before. I squeezed his hand in reassurance, my eyes smarting when I felt his return squeeze. It felt like I was a little girl again, finding comfort in my dad's presence. The one who'd believed everything would be okay as long as he was there.
As long as you're healthy. That's all that matters.
Dad sounded gruff as he picked up his coffee again. Jen and I pretended not to see the sheen in his eyes as he turned his face toward the window.
If you can't have pancakes, what can you eat?
Syrup was smeared on my niece's lips and chin. A few spots on her jacket glistened where it had dripped.
Blood and nightmares.
Connor stuffed a bite of pancake in his mouth. Linda's nose wrinkled.
Ew! Does that mean you're a vampire?
Yes, and I've come to suck your blood.
I curled my fingers into claws and reached for Linda. She shrieked and backed away laughing.
Okay, okay.
Jenna blocked her daughter's flailing hand when it almost hit her in the face. A second later, she removed the fork with a speared piece of pancake from Linda's hand and set it on the plate. Enough playing around before you hurt someone.
Sorry, Mommy.
Linda didn't resist as Jenna took her hands to clean the syrup off them. While Jenna was preoccupied with her daughter, I rested my head on my hand to watch Connor eat.
How is your first time eating pancakes?
Linda stared at Connor with her mouth open.
You've never had pancakes before?
No.
How is that possible?
Linda gasped.
Pancakes are the best. They are everything.
Linda wasn't the only one surprised. Dad and Jenna stared at him in confusion.
They don't have them where I'm from.
Connor tucked another bite into his mouth and chewed, unconcerned by their reactions. From his expression, it was hard to tell if he was enjoying the pancakes or not. Where's that? Jenna asked, quick to seize the opportunity to learn a little more about the person I'd introduced into our circle. Ireland, I answered. Before Connor could. Part of me feared he'd mention the Fae land where he'd spent his last few centuries. It was best to cut him off before that could happen. Dad still looked suspicious, but he didn't press. White-hot agony pierced my mind. I clutched at my head as a whimper escaped from between clenched teeth.
Aileen? Aileen!
What's wrong with her?
Dad and Jenna's frightened expressions registered, but I was too busy trying to ride the wave of pain swamping my senses to reassure them. Connor grabbed my shoulders, lowering me until I was lying on the bench. The pain receded a tiny bit, still there, but not as overwhelming. From a distance, I could hear Dad's raised voice and Jenna trying to calm Linda down. A voice boomed in my mind.
Child.
As quickly as it had come, the pain vanished. It became nothing more than a hazy memory as my mind tried to convince itself that someone wasn't just digging their fingers into a place where they didn't belong. What the fuck was that? As if the situation wasn't embarrassing enough, liquid started to drip out of my nose and onto my upper lip as I forced myself up to sitting. Blood. That's just great. Oh my God, Aileen! Jenna grabbed napkins from the dispenser. 2/3 of them ripped. That didn't stop her. She inked one after another out until she had a large pile she could then shove in my direction. You have a nosebleed! I took the napkins and pressed them against my nose, wishing I was alone with Connor so I could ask him what the hell was going on.
You okay?
Connor asked. Let me get back to you on that. I wasn't sure what I was feeling right now. Angry, certainly. A little scared. Maybe a lot scared. And about every emotion in between. A person's mind was supposed to be sacrosanct. Mine wasn't. And that was terrifying. Connor's focus turned inward, his expression remote. I didn't take his withdrawal personally. This wasn't good. Someone with power of this nature could have turned my mind into Swiss cheese. Worse, I had no idea how to keep the invasion from happening again. Seeing the concern on my family's faces, I lowered the wad of now bloody napkins to give them a reassuring smile. Sorry about this. Jenna's tiny flinch made me cover my lips with the napkins again. Maybe smiling wasn't such a good idea after all. My dad's face expression looked like it had been chiseled out of granite. Linda was the only one to show appreciation, mouthing a silent, "Cool." Way to go, self. Stellar job appearing normal and well-adjusted.
You don't have to apologize.
My dad nudged Jenna's shoulder, nodding for her to scoot out of the booth.
But I think it's best if we take it to a hospital to get checked out.
Linda, sensing her time was limited, shoveled several bites of pancake into her mouth as she shuffled sideways. Reaching the end of the table, she hovered over her food for those last few bites. That's not necessary, Dad, I protested. A visit to the hospital was the last thing I needed. I wasn't sure how much human technology could glean from our blood, but I didn't want to chance it. Even with Thomas's people seated within the phlebotomy labs, there was no reason to be reckless. There weren't a lot of universal rules in the spook world, but not giving humans evidence of our existence was a big one. Besides, Dad and Jenna would probably find it suspicious when the doctors had never heard of what I had. I needed an excuse. A good one, preferably one my family could accept.
I think it's very necessary, Dad said in his dad voice.
That particular tone had always let me know when a situation wasn't up for discussion. Unfortunately, the threat of punishment no longer worked on me. I wasn't afraid of a grounding or missing dessert. Dad and Jenna couldn't afford for me to be nice about this. I promise you, it's nothing, I assured him. This is a possible side effect of the medicine I'm on, an unexpected one with how well I've been doing until now.
Wow, this time I almost believed that. My ability to tell lies had evolved a long way from my teen years. Too bad Dad didn't look convinced. Jenna either.
The stubbornness I saw in their faces made it clear they weren't going to let this go. In their place, I wouldn't either. I would have fought to ensure they got the necessary care for whatever mysterious illness they had, whether they shared the name of the illness or not.
I was going to have to be mean to get them to back off.
It would probably undo all the work I'd done until now. And yet, I was going to do it to save them from something worse down the line. Connor set his fork down and patted his lips with a napkin.
You do not need to worry. I will call our personal physician to attend to her when we reach home. He is familiar with her situation and will know what steps need to be taken.
My dad's expression loosened. He knew me too well and had been braced for a fight. That made me hate myself. Just a little. Dad had always been my safe harbor. My mom and I always clashed, but he'd been my rock. I wish I was the daughter he deserved, not this person filled with secrets, not someone he had to protect himself from. Connor rose, bowing his head to my father in respect.
I regret that this means we will need to take our leave.
Next to him, I felt like a lumbering monster as I fought my way out of the booth. I made sure to take the bloody napkins with me. After what just happened, I didn't want to chance any piece of me falling into the wrong hands. Blood was an important ingredient in some spells. It was an easy way to get cursed. Now that I was thinking about it, many of my enemies were witches, or at least versed in spell work. I'd have to check to see if there had ever been an opportunity for someone to obtain a sample of my blood. My dad returned to Connor's bow with a nod before heading toward the waitress to ask for the check. Connor's expression turned morose. What's wrong? I asked. Connor was the master of the micro expression, a beautiful work of art that was impossible to know the heart of unless he told you. It took a lot to make him show anything on that face of his.
I had hoped to pay.
Connor's frown held a touch of pouting.
From what I read, paying is a way to leave a good impression on prospective fathers.
I'm pretty sure you understood that wrong, I said, fighting a smirk. Connor clearly didn't understand the difference between a father versus a prospective father-in-law.
Are you sure?
I nodded and patted his shoulder. Yup. Let Dad pay, Jenna interjected. It's his way of welcoming you to the family, now that you're Aileen's brother and all. I was the only one who caught Jenna's sarcasm. It went right over Connor's head as he nodded, accepting her words at face value.
I see,
he said, sounding serious.
I will accept his good intentions, then.
Jenna's teeth dented her lower lip, her eyes alight with a mirth I hadn't seen in a long time. Linda looked up at Connor.
Does this mean you're my uncle now?
Jenna's expression softened, her teasing fading as she smoothed Linda's hair away from her face. I sometimes forgot, because of how good a mom Jenna was, that Linda didn't have a lot of positive male role models in her life. As a result, she tended to glom on to any man who came into her orbit. It was one of the reasons Jenna had hesitated to introduce any of the men she dated to Linda. She didn't want Linda getting attached, only for the relationship to end. It showed how much Connor's actions had won Jenna's approval if she wasn't trying to head Linda off at the pass. A warm feeling filled my center. It was kind of nice watching two important people in my life get along. Connor gave Linda's question serious thought.
I suppose that wouldn't be wrong.
I shook my head in amused resignation before herding the other three toward the exit. My dad would follow when he finished paying the bill. Linda and Jenna were giggling together as Connor and I brought up the rear. Their abrupt stop a second later caused me to nearly bump into their backs. It took several quick side shuffles to avoid running them over. Only after that did I understand the reason for their sudden caution. A black Escalade was parked in the no parking zone directly in front of the restaurant. By itself, that wouldn't be alarming. It was the man leaning against its side like a grim specter of death that was the problem. Dressed all in black and looking about as approachable as an assassin, he was obviously waiting for us. What are you doing here, Nathan? I asked with a scowl. An enforcer for the master of the city, Nathan possessed an easy charisma that many found disarming. They never saw what lay beyond that deceptive charm. As flirtatious as he seemed, Nathan was a stone-cold killer. A psycho,
just like the rest of them, even if he hid it better. It was what made him so good at what he did. No one ever saw him coming. His gaze sharpened as he pushed off the SUV and stalked toward me. Jenna pulled Linda behind her as he caught my chin and tilted it upward for a better look.
What happened to you?
I slapped his hand off my face. Nathan let me. Nothing. He set his hands on his hips, looking angry.
You had a bloody nose.
I covered my face, feeling self-conscious. I thought I'd gotten all the blood off before we left the restaurant, though I guess not well enough to fool a vampire. I'll tell you about it later, I said, waving away his concern. This wasn't the place to get into it, not with my sister and niece standing a few feet away. Nathan let me dodge the question, for now anyways. His steady gaze made it clear that wouldn't last, though. Are you going to answer my earlier question? I asked, changing the subject.
To pick you up, of course. Did you forget what day it was?
I searched my memory. Would it be bad if I said yes?
You did forget.
The pitch of Nathan's voice made it difficult to determine if he was delighted or scandalized by that knowledge. His gaze swung toward Connor.
Don't tell me you did, too.
The deer in headlights expression on his face made Nathan let out a mocking laugh.
Thomas must be going crazy by now.
Nathan shook his finger at the two of us.
I'm surprised he hasn't been blowing up your phones, demanding to know where you are.
The guilty expression on both our faces gave us away. Nathan's eyes widened before he snickered.
No wonder Liam sent me.
Oh, I think I remembered now. The quarterly meet and greet, I whispered. That's tonight. Nathan snapped his fingers and pointed at me.
Got it in one.
Connor and I shared similar looks of dread. I forgot, I whispered. Connor, too, it seemed. In establishing our own house, we, because there was no way I was venturing into that shark tank alone, were required to attend formal functions as part of our new roles. I was the house head, and Connor was my right hand. The meet and greet tonight was a quarterly meeting for the clans and houses in the city and nearby areas. Our presence was expected and required. Thomas had told me several weeks ago, but I'd promptly put it out of my mind.
That is clear,
Nathan drawled, his gaze shifting toward my dad as he joined us outside.
Who's this?
Dad asked. I glared at Nathan. He'd better be on his best behavior around my family. I might not be able to make him physically regret crossing me, but I bet Connor could. He seems to be Eileen's friend, Jenna volunteered, acting less than certain as she picked up on my tension.
Actually, I'm her boss.
I blew a raspberry. As if. More like a minion. Nathan held his hands to his chest in mock hurt.
Is that how you see me after all this time?
Keep going. See how much further I can reduce your status. Knowing I'd do exactly as I said, Nathan cut his losses, instead focusing on my niece.
Are you the little ballerina I've heard so much about?
Linda blinked up at him in surprise.
How did you know?
One ballet aficionado recognizes the next.
Really?
Linda's face lit up at the prospect of someone else, an adult no less, sharing her favorite hobby. In answer, Nathan executed an emboîté, transitioning into a pirouette that had Linda clapping. She bounced forward on her toes.
You're so good.
He definitely was. Watching him was like seeing poetry in motion. Each movement as graceful and perfect as the last. Nathan quirked an eyebrow at my expression.
Surprised?
Don't be ridiculous. You're the one who taught me swing dancing. I didn't find it strange that he knew other forms of dance as well, especially given his level of talent in it. Nathan offered my sister his hand.
You must be Ms. Grumpy's sister.
That's an apt description of her, Jenna said with a smile.
Was she always like this? Nathan asked. From the day she was born, Dad answered.
Nathan peeked in my direction, his playful grin making it clear he was having fun at my expense.
I'm sure you two have a lot of stories I can use to torture Aileen with later.
Jenna nodded, her expression as gleeful as her daughter's had been earlier.
We do.
That's enough of that, Minion. It's time to be on our way.
I stepped between the two before any further damage could be done.
Afraid, Lena?
Jenna teased.
About Nathan learning my secrets?
Yes. Unequivocally so. The man was a terror. No way did I want stories of my childhood falling into his hands.
You don't trust me, eh?
I narrowed my eyes at the enforcer.
Not even a little bit.
At least not when it came to this. My life, on the other hand, was a different story. Nathan was one of the few I trusted at my back.
I guess I can understand that,
he murmured, not seeming too put out at my caution.
That's mighty big of you, Minion.
Nathan gestured to the car.
Now that that's settled, shall we?
I didn't move.
There's no need. I parked not far from here. We'll meet you there.
Nathan shook his head.
No can do, eh? My orders are clear. You and Connor in this vehicle.
I'm not leaving Gwyneth here overnight.
No need. I already arranged to have your car picked up and taken home.
A throaty rumble came from the end of the street as a Jaguar F-Type roared into view. The exterior was a distinctive burnt umber that I had only seen once. On my car.
Tell me you didn't, I growled. I kind of did.
The Jaguar passed us, giving me a glimpse of the driver as he gunned the engine.
Anton? That's who you let drive Gwyneth? That's who he trusted my precious to?
Gwyneth? Jenna repeated to herself, sounding confused.
It would appear so.
I stomped toward the curb.
Not a scratch, Anton. Do you hear me? Not a scratch, or I will end you.
She knows he can't hear her, right?
Jenna whispered to Connor.
He could hear me. He'd better pay attention, too, or retribution would be mine.
I turned and stomped back to Nathan.
You know my rules. Nobody drives the precious but me.
Nathan's shrug was unconcerned.
Next time, show up when you're supposed to, and this won't be a problem.
Unbelievable.
I'm sure this is important, but Aileen needs to be checked out by a doctor before she does anything else,
my dad said with a stubborn tilt to his jaw. Nathan's nod was respectful.
We have one on site, so that won't be a problem.
His reassurance did a little to allay my dad's concern.
I'll wait in the car while you say your goodbyes, eh?
Nathan slung an arm over Connor's shoulder, guiding him to the car.
Why don't you join me?
Connor pulled open the back door and climbed inside. Nathan shot us a grin before sauntering around the car to the driver's side.
Employee of yours?
Jenna asked, looking far too interested in Nathan's backside for my peace of mind. More like a contractor, though after tonight, I'm regretting that.
If I could, I would have ended any contract between us in a heartbeat for the crime of touching Gwyneth.
He seems interesting, Jenna said.
Trust me, don't go there. As charming as he was, Nathan was a heartbreak waiting to happen. Any relationship between the two was doomed, both because he was a vampire and because he had a short attention span when it came to the opposite sex. There was no way I'd trust him with my little sister.
A man like that? I don't need forever with.
Jenna shoved me playfully with her shoulder, keeping her voice low so her daughter wouldn't hear.
A few nights would more than suffice.
Dad pulled the two of us apart with a shake of his head.
All right, that's not the kind of thing I want to hear.
Me neither, Dad, I mumbled. More importantly, I wish Nathan wouldn't have heard that either. Jenna's smirk was unrepentant as she lifted a shoulder in a shrug.
so glad she was enjoying my secondhand embarrassment.
Promise me you'll get that checkup,
Dad said, ignoring his other daughter.
I will. Nathan and Connor will make sure of it.
I stepped forward to offer him a hug. His frame seemed to freeze for a split second before his arms came up to hug me back a little harder than usual. I pretended not to hear the faint catch in his throat. It made me realize it had been too long since the last time I'd hugged anyone in my family. I'd been too afraid of my strength after my transition. I was worried I'd hurt them or lose control of my bloodlust. His grip gentled as he suddenly remembered I was sick. He was holding me like I was something fragile. A few seconds later, I ducked my head to hide my wet eyes as I stepped back. Dad's swallow was audible as he looked away.
Let me know if there's anything you need after your talk with the doctor.
I nodded.
I will.
Jenna stepped forward to give me a briefer, but no less welcome, hug.
It's rare we get to see you these days. I was hoping for a little more time. My friends are having a girls' night tomorrow. You can join us if you want, I blurted, the words seeming to fall out of my mouth against my wishes.
Say no, I urged mentally, wishing I could take my offer back. Say you can't get away and have to watch Linda.
Anything but that you'll come.
With Caroline? Jenna asked.
And others?
All of them spooks, friends I'd made over the last few years. Now that I had time to reconsider, I realized just how bad of an idea it had been to invite Jenna into that dynamic.
Too late to take it back now.
I'll be there. I faked a smile. I'll send the details. Happiness shone from every inch of Jenna's body.
Great.
Before my big mouth could dig any more holes I couldn't get myself out of, I headed toward the Escalade. I climbed into the passenger seat, waving once at my family before slamming the door shut.
Girls' night, huh?
Nathan asked.
I don't want to talk about it.
Nathan started the car.
You sure that's a good idea?
Definitely not.
But it was happening. God help me.
3.
The sound of puking came as Nathan started the car. I looked into the back seat to find Connor bent over and heaving.
What happened to being able to handle it?
Connor's features held regret as he wiped his mouth and straightened from his hunched-over position.
You were right. I was too ambitious.
Nathan twisted in his seat.
Did he seriously just throw up in this car?
The stunned outrage on his face made me bite back a smile.
Right behind me, too? Are you kidding me?
His voice held a touch of hysteria.
How am I supposed to drive thinking about it sloshing around? What if it comes up here when I hit the brakes?
Nathan started dry-retching. I patted him sympathetically on the shoulder.
I've decided to forgive you for letting Anton drive Gwyneth.
You were right. This was a much better idea than taking my car. Nathan's shoulders went rigid.
Did you know this was going to happen?
Don't laugh. Don't laugh.
How could I? Nathan scowled at Connor.
Did you do this on purpose?
Connor's face was blank as he met Nathan's gaze. Unsatisfied, Nathan spun back to me.
What did you mean earlier by handle it?
I tried to appear unaffected. Probably not very well, since a smile kept trying to break out on my face.
Nothing much.
Nathan squinted at me, trying to see through my facade. His eyes widened in realization.
He ate something, didn't he?
My shoulders started shaking with silent laughter. He whirled on Connor.
What did you eat?
Connor's stare made it plain he didn't intend to answer. It wasn't until I made a small,
come on,
gesture that he deigned to open his mouth.
Triple cinnamon pancakes.
Nathan's face held disbelief as he looked at me.
You let him eat that crap?
I shrugged. He's a big boy, and he said he could handle it.
Which was why it was doubly satisfying to see that, no, He could, in fact, not handle triple cinnamon pancakes with a side of bacon and ham. "Are we going?" I asked after a few seconds, when Nathan continued to regard us like we were aliens. "We're going to attract attention if we keep sitting here." Nathan faced front in his seat, muttering to himself as he put the car in drive again.
"He's going to clean that up when we arrive. You know that, right?"
Connor's silence spoke for itself as he stared out the window at the passing scenery.
"No can do," I answered for him. "We have a meet and greet, remember? It's why you interrupted our evening in such a rude fashion."
"You're enjoying this," Nathan snapped.
"So very much." Words could not describe how happy Connor had made me. It was so perfectly timed that it made me wonder if he'd done it on purpose. A tiny revenge for Nathan's high-handedness. If so, bravo, brother. I chuckled at the idea of it.
"You realize payback is coming," Nathan warned me. "It's going to be hard payback."
"But not before you have to clean out your ride," I returned gleefully. And that was going to take a lot of effort and time. The stench of throw-up was as pervasive as death and would cling to everything. I was betting he'd have to detail the car several times to be rid of it. A vampire's senses were heightened, after all. The thought was oh so sweet.
"Enjoy it while you can, eh?" Nathan rumbled. "I'll be sure to return the favor in kind."
"But not before suffering for a while." I was petty enough to think the trade-off worthwhile. "How did you know where I was?" I asked as we headed south on Grandview Avenue toward Goodale Boulevard.
"Do you really think I'm going to answer that?" Nathan asked with a sidelong look that told me he was still sore about the whole throw-up situation.
By now, Connor had abandoned the seat behind Nathan in favor of the one on the passenger side. He was quiet as we drove, lost in his own world.
"Honestly, I expected a little bragging," I answered.
Nathan snorted.
"A magician never reveals his secrets."
"You're not a magician, though."
"I could be if I wanted. I'd make an excellent addition to their ranks," Nathan grumbled.
Of that, I had no doubt. He was a master at misdirection.
"You ever going to tell me why you had blood leaking out of your nose before I showed up?" Nathan asked.
I looked out the window to avoid the question.
"Come on, eh? What's going on?"
Seeing my reluctance, Nathan crooned.
"Tell your big brother, Nathan, all your little secrets."
I couldn't help smiling at his cajoling. "It's nothing."
"If you're bleeding, it is."
The playfulness dropped from his face as Nathan turned serious.
"Nosebleeds aren't normal for us. You should know that."
I shifted in my seat, a little uncomfortable. He was right. I did know. With a sigh, I explained what happened in the restaurant. The pain, the voice afterwards. Nathan listened carefully as he turned onto Goodale and headed toward the arena district near the downtown area.
"That's not nothing," he said after I finished. "Someone able to breach your mind like that is a concern." "I agree,"
Connor said from the back seat.
"Your mental defenses are some of the best I've ever seen. I don't know of anyone who could have done that." "You have to tell Thomas," Nathan said, looking over at me. "You don't have a choice. He needs to know."
I stretched my legs out as far as I could and crossed them. "Don't worry, I'm aware. Not even I would take chances with something like this." Thomas had way more experience in these things. If anyone could help, it was him. Or at least he'd know someone who could. Besides, he owed me. "I'm surprised Thomas sent you and Anton," I said, changing the subject. As enforcers, they had better things to do than retrieve the master of the city's offspring for a small meet and greet like this. No one particularly important was supposed to be there, just the clan matriarchs and patriarchs. along with a few vampires hoping to petition to start their own house. All of them were well acquainted with my eccentricities. My absence would hardly be a surprise.
Thomas didn't.
I sent him a surprised look.
Liam sent you?
A grunt was all the answer I got. I sank into thought, troubled by this new piece of information. In addition to being my lover, Liam was the head enforcer for the master of the city, and Nathan's boss. He didn't normally step into the middle of Thomas's power games. For him to interfere like this meant something was up. Something big.
What's going on?
I asked. Nathan shook his head, his irritation vanishing.
I don't know. They're not sharing. Whatever it is, though, it's got them antsy.
An antsy, Thomas and Liam. I didn't think there was anything worse. I glanced over my shoulder to find Connor paying attention to the conversation. His gaze shifted to me. He shook his head, as lost as I was. I faced forward again.
Great.
The remainder of the drive was completed in silence. Each of us were left to our own thoughts as we passed under the highway and then over the Olentangy River, a few miles north of where it joined the Scioto. From there, we made our way toward the Arena District, an area known as the play center of the city. The district had gone through many incarnations before reaching its current version. In the late 1800s, it was an industrial corridor, complete with a railroad hub. Union Station and most of the train tracks were gone now, but an arch from its arcade remained in the McPherson Commons Park. At one time, there was a penitentiary that served as the city's prison until it was closed and demolished. The prison held the dubious distinction of being home to the worst prison fire in history, killing 322 inmates in the 1930s. By the time a proposal to revitalize this part of the city was put forth, the area was mostly abandoned. The houses and former factories had sat empty for years. It wasn't until the mid-90s that it was redeveloped into what it is now, a district with a thriving nightlife. That was probably a big reason the vampires had claimed this section of the city as their hunting grounds. They owned the majority of the clubs, bars, and restaurants in the area, using them to pick out their evening's meal. No one would notice a human who was staggering a little more than usual because of blood loss rather than inebriation. Most of the time, the human didn't even remember the encounter. Likely the result of the combination of vampire compulsion and alcohol. If they did remember, they'd chalk up the bite to a kinky interlude with a stranger. Nathan pulled up in front of Asylum, a trendy nightclub owned by Clan Davinish. The spot he'd chosen wasn't an actual parking spot, but that didn't stop him as he climbed out of the SUV to toss his keys at the valet waiting by the curb.
I want it detailed before you give it back to me, Nathan ordered as he stalked past.
Connor and I followed. A smile tugged at the corner of my mouth.
Do you really think that will make a difference?
Nathan herded me toward the club's entrance, bypassing the line of waiting humans.
You'd better hope it does.
Ooh, threats.
I pretended to shiver.
We're so scared, aren't we, Connor?
The other man blinked and tilted his head to give me a confused look.
No.
His response made me snicker as the bouncers opened the doors for us.
Welcome to the asylum.
His wide smile revealed the points of his fangs.
Vampire. Hey!
A woman yelled from the other side of the velvet rope.
Why did they get to skip the line?
Another bouncer held up a pacifying hand and moved to block us from view.
Trust me, you don't want to make a fuss about them.
Her response was lost as we entered the club. The bass of the music ran through the floor, a mass of bodies heaving to the beat.
Was Asylum renovated?
I asked, stopping to take a look around the club.
It looked different than the last time I'd been here.
The theme was macabre, with a flare of steampunk. Red and black dominated.
Velvet covered the booths, while bronze decorated the lighting fixtures. The artwork on the walls was equally riveting. In one, a woman wore a black Victorian outfit. A large hat called attention to the skull where her face should have been. In another, a woman in a white nightgown stepped down into a pool of black skulls. The waitstaff were dressed to match the theme, their clothes walking the line between costume and uniform, their dramatic makeup making them appear as creepy as the decor. At my question, the bartender looked up from where he was serving a crowd of humans. The skin around his eyes had been painted black and a white powder used on the rest of his face. Nathan brushed past me, moving deeper into the club.
Sophia felt it was time for a change.
It looks amazing.
She'll appreciate the compliment,
a woman declared from the top of the stairs that led up to the second floor mezzanine, where only VIPs were allowed. With one hand on the rail, she had the grace of a queen as she descended the stairs. Her poise was all the more impressive because of the sky-high, black, lace-covered heels she wore. I knew they couldn't have been easy to walk in. Sienna reached the bottom of the stairs and gave me a faint smile.
You're late.
Why does everyone keep saying that?
I can only be considered late if I agree to come in the first place, which I didn't actually remember doing. Barely audible uh-huhs on the way to work didn't count.
Sienna's smile grew into a real one, exposing the tips of her fangs. African-American, her hair exploded around her head in a halo of tight corkscrew curls, coupled with her gorgeous...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.